Well, you can see from your bulletins that the title of tonight's message is the same as the name of the hymn that we just sung, The Love of God. And by the love of God, I do not mean God's love for you, but your love for God. So that's what I'd like to focus our attention on tonight as we walk together through these verses in John 14, verse 15 through verse 24. I want to center our attention on the love of God, but meaning by that, us loving God back. But before we do that, let's give ourselves to a word of prayer. Shall we pray? Father in heaven, I think that we are right to say that the love of God, both your love for us and our love for you, is the reason we exist. It's the reason there is a church. It's the reason that we have life. It's the reason that Christ came down into the world to save sinners. Father, we are at the core of reality tonight. And so I pray for the help of your Spirit to help me make these words, which are beautiful, which are powerful, and which are spiritual, help me, O God, to make them plain. You've commissioned the ministers in your church to feed your sheep. So I pray to that end that you would make the words of my mouth and the meditations of our heart together tonight pleasing and acceptable to you, O Lord our God, our rock, and our Redeemer. Through Christ we ask it. Amen. Well, I'd like to begin by asking you to look with me, if you have a bulletin, at that third verse of the hymn, The Love of God. We just sung it a moment ago. The words go like this: could we with ink the ocean fill, and were the skies of parchment made, were every stalk on earth a quill, and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above, would drain the ocean dry. Nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. So you have there an image of someone trying to love God back, trying to say that if I were to love God in the way that He has loved me, the oceans of the world would have to be ink, and every twig and branch and plant life on earth would have to be a quill. And were we all to write in the eternal skies the glory of God's love, it would not be enough space. Now those are the words of someone who wants to love God back. Those are the words of someone who has seen in Jesus Christ what John the son of Zebedee saw, namely the glory of God and the love of God come down in human flesh. But this person, having seen that in Jesus, having believed Jesus to be that Son of God, and having experienced that love, this person who wrote those words is not content to just receive God's love. This person must love God back. Now, loving God back is not something we often emphasize when we talk about the love of God. But loving God back is the meaning of life. Loving God back is the end to which the Bible speaks. The Bible ends with God and man on earth in a fellowship of love. And we'll talk about that more as we go through the verses. But as I said a minute ago, loving God back is why the Father sent the Son into the world. We have seen his glory, John said, glory as of the only begotten Son, who is resting on the chest or the bosom of the Father. That Son has come down and revealed to us the love of God. So I say all that to say that we are not surprised when we discover that the theme of our verses tonight is loving God back. That's what Jesus is talking about in verses 15 to 24 of John 14. And this is something that the true disciple wants to know. This is something that the true disciple, the true follower of Jesus, is searching to know. How can I love God back? And again, the hymn is one man trying to express what he would have to do it right. How do I love God back? How do I return the love of God with the love of God? How do I return the love that God has shown me freely with the love that I now have for God? How do I do that? Now, these verses are addressed to people like that, to people who want to love God back. And we're given by Jesus three instructions, three words for how to love God back. And they're very simple and they're very plain. As we walk together through the verses, we'll see them. Number one, we love God back by keeping His commandments, keeping Jesus' commandments. Number two, we love God back by receiving God's Spirit. And number three, we love God back by enjoying fellowship with God. So let's look through those one at a time. First, with loving God back by keeping God's commandments. So to love God is to do what He has said to do. The Bible wants to say very clearly in verse 14 of chapter 15 that loving God back is doing what He has said to do. That's more than obedience. That is love. Now, and what is He said to do in verse 15? Well, it's very clear. God has said right there in verse 15 to keep the commandments of Jesus. Now, let's think for a second as we are together in verse 15. So far, what has taken place in the upper room? Let's step back and remember all that's taken place in the upper room since we entered this scene back in chapter 13. So Jesus has sat down at table with His disciples, and He is sharing with them the Passover meal. Now, during the supper, He got up, he took off the garments that He was wearing, and He put on the garments of a servant, a household servant, and then He washed His disciples' feet. Now, when He did that, He was signifying to them two things. One, the meaning of His death, that His death would cleanse His disciples from their sin and from their guilt, just as the water that He applied to their feet was cleansing the dirt from their body. So that's the first thing. Second thing, when He washed their feet, it signified how the church was supposed to live as a community. And all of this was once Jesus returned to the Father. So Jesus going back to the Father, and He says, this is what my death is going to mean, and this is how you're supposed to live. Now from there, and this is what we've looked at in the last 2 weeks, He taught them two things. One, to love one another. And two, which we looked at last week, to follow His ways. And now He's saying that if they love Him, they are to express their love by keeping His commandments after He departs. So Jesus says, I've spoken to you about my love for you and about your love for one another, but what I have not yet said anything about is your love for me. And if that's something that you really have, then the way you love me back is by keeping my commandments. So Jesus is loving us when He tells us to keep His word, when He tells us to do what He has told us to do in the Bible. Now there's a lesson here that's very subtle that I'll try to pull out by telling you a story that I personally experienced as I was listening to a Bible teacher walk a class of adults through the story of Nadab and Abihu in Leviticus chapter 10. Now, to give you just a, I won't go through the whole story, but just so that we're all on the same page. The story of Nadab and Abihu is after the Israelites are in the Sinai Peninsula. They have put together the tabernacle that God showed Moses on Mount Sinai. They have consecrated Aaron as the priest. And this is the first worship service. The first sacrifice is all offered by Aaron. And once the sacrifice is offered, God consumes that sacrifice with a flash of holy fire, and the people know that they have done what God commanded them to do. It's a beautiful moment. It's a victorious moment. It's the people realizing that God is their God, that what Moses was doing up on Sinai had a purpose, that we really are in a covenant with the living God. But no sooner than that happens do Aaron's two sons, Nadab and Abihu, take their censers, their long poles with fire on them, and light fire on the altar that was not fire that God had instructed priests to offer. And at that moment, they drop dead, just like Ananias and Sapphira in Acts chapter 5. Now, this Bible teacher was helping this class think through that, work through that, and interpret it. And he did a masterful job because he never told them his answer. He let them arrive at it together. And so as he's talking, one lady pipes up and says, "Are you saying that reciprocity," that was her word, but we could say love, "are you saying that love has to be commanded?" And he said, "Yes. Yes." You see, the lesson, he said, of Nadab and Abihu is that God tells us how to love Him back. And if we decide or choose to love Him in a way that we want to, but as a way that He has not commanded, that's not love, no matter what we call it. Because it's not obedience. Because you see, it's because God is God and Jesus is Lord that the right way to love Him is by obeying Him. That's the right relationship. That's what a loving relationship looks like between God and Maker. So you see that underneath obedience is love. And love expresses itself in doing what Jesus has told us to do. That's the way that the relationship between God and people is supposed to work. There's a powerful quote by John Calvin on this subject. Because, if you think about it, I don't think anyone on any particular Sunday walks into the doors of a church and professes not to love Jesus. But Jesus has totally redefined what that actually means by doing what He says. So John Calvin put it this way: of those who think that they love Christ, very few honor Him by observing His doctrine. So everyone says that they love Christ, but it's only those who keep Jesus' commandments that actually do. So if you think about church life for a second, if we are here to be in a loving relationship with God, ought not what we, the things we do as a church, have in mind as the goal helping one another want to obey Jesus' commands? Is not that the purpose of our prayer ministry, of our teaching ministry, of our children's ministry, of our outreach ministry? Ought not everything we do in a church have as its goal helping one another want to obey Jesus? Not perform rote obedience because we think that's what Christians are supposed to do. That's not what Jesus is talking about. Jesus is talking about obedience that comes from a desire to love Me back. And so what we're trying to do in one another, with one another, is help one another get to that heart place where we experience Jesus together and we help one another want to do what He says. So that's the first way that we love God back. Now the second is that we love God by receiving His Spirit. So to love God, Jesus says next in verses 16 to 20, receive the Spirit of God. Receive my Spirit, Jesus says. Now, verse 18 shows us why Jesus seems to be shifting subjects really abruptly, very abruptly. Because if you read verse 16 next to verse 15, it's hard to understand why Jesus shifts to talk about another helper when he's just talked about love. But verse 18 helps us understand why he does that. Because you remember, his disciples have heard him say that he's leaving. And they are afraid, as they would naturally be. Their leader, their Lord, their teacher, has said he's going away. So their experience is, well, I'm about to become an orphan. And it's very powerful that Jesus chooses the word orphan, because it explains the type of relationship that they have developed with their teacher. This is not just student and teacher. This has become father and children. It is intimate. It's close. It's real. And so they're afraid that their spiritual parent, their father, is about to leave them. They're afraid they're about to become orphans. And so Jesus says, you ought not feel that way. Because after I depart, I'm going to send to you another helper. I can tell you a story to help you understand what Jesus means when he says, I'm going to send to you another helper. I was traveling, I believe I was traveling with my parents. I think my brother might have been there too. And maybe it was just with my mother. And we got a flat tire. And although I wish I had the skills to fix a flat tire and do that with ease, I think my brother and I were trying, but we were fumbling through the owner's manual, and we finally figured out where the jack was, and it was this big, and the car was a huge SUV, so even once we got the car jacked up, we're like, who's getting under there? Because I'm not totally sure that my head's not going to meet the pavement if I get under that car with that jack. And then as we're there, and I'm sure several passersby could see us fumbling through this, but as we were working, a truck pulled up behind us. And out of the truck got out an African-American man with his son. And he was wearing camouflage pants. He was an Army serviceman. And he gets out, and he's rolling a huge jack. And he's very friendly. He comes, and he doesn't criticize or make fun of our job that my brother and I did. But he does take his jack, and he lifts the car higher than our little jack could. It's much more stable. He, of course, loosened the tire before he did that. He takes it off. He puts the other one on, tightens it up. And I don't remember him saying anything, but I remember him being very, very friendly and very, very helpful. That is the sort of help that Jesus says this helper, the Spirit of God, will always give you. He will always give you that help because Jesus says, I'm sending him to be with you always. I love the way one Bible teacher has put it. He said, the helper will take Jesus' place after Jesus departs. He will lead the Christian community by doing nothing other than what Jesus was doing, only with this one exception. In doing it, he will promote Jesus' name and not his own. Now, how exactly the helper will help the church, Jesus makes plain there in verse 20. On that day, the day that the Spirit comes, you will have a fresh and real experience of what I've already told you. And what I've already told you is that I am in the Father, you are in me, and I am in you. The church fathers, those who led and taught the church in the first centuries of the church, they used a metaphor to describe this, to describe what Jesus says there in verse 20. The metaphor was called perichoresis. Perichoresis was an ancient Greek dance in which three people would join hands and they would circle and they would revolve and rotate around one another, and they would just dance and they would move throughout a room or throughout a space. They'd be going in circles, but they would be moving forward together, and they would be moving. And the ancient fathers would say that this is how God is. There is this divine community of love between Father, Son, and Spirit, in which each person is moving from their person in other-centered love, and they are giving themselves while simultaneously receiving the other. And this is the way any loving relationships work. It is a matter of giving yourself and receiving the other, giving in love and receiving the beloved. And the divine community was just always moving this way in this circle of love, this dance of love. And the ancients would say that the role of the Spirit was to bring the believing church into this community of love. That this is where the church is to live, as a community of the Spirit, that they are to enter this perichoretic dance. Now, if you think about that, if that's what Jesus says the church is, and if I have learned anything in my few years of ministry, I have learned that the church is a community. Now, it may be an organized community, but it is at its core a community, a fellowship. And it is a fellowship that ought to be one in which this spiritual life of love and unity is present. That's what we're supposed to be working toward, according to the book of Ephesians, that we are to be growing up in Christ so that we're united in God and united in one another. Meaning, practically, that the one place on earth where the world is supposed to see perichoresis, real unity and togetherness, is the church. But is the church known for its unity? Are we as Christians, particularly Christians in America, known for our togetherness, known for our other person-centeredness? Or are we known for our divisiveness? Are we known for our selfishness? Are we known, rather than giving ourselves and receiving another, are we known for taking for ourselves and hurting the other? Is that what the world sees? Now, if it is, and I know that's broad brush, but if it is, that must mean that what the church is really lacking is love for God. Because for that to be true, for there to be disunity in a body, we must be refusing to listen to the Spirit, because it is the Spirit's role who brings us into the divine dance, who unites us to God and to one another. That's what Jesus says in verse 20. On the day that the Spirit comes, you will know that I am in you, and I am in the Father, and you are in me. You'll know that by a real experience, because the Spirit will make that plain. So, if we don't know that, if we don't experience that, that must mean that we are either quenching the Spirit, refusing the Spirit, or ignoring the Spirit. And all of that is seen by refusing to do what Jesus says to do. So that's number two. We have one more way that Jesus teaches us to love God back. And that last way is by enjoying God. The last way that we're taught in verses 21 to 24 to love God is by enjoying His company, by enjoying His fellowship. So, if we've read verses 15 to 20 correctly, we ask ourselves, what does it look like for Jesus' disciples to enter the perichoresis, to enter the divine community of love? How are we supposed to live as members of the family of God? Well, Jesus answers that in verses 21 to 24 by saying that they are to love me by keeping my commandments. Now, it's most important for you to see, given what I've said about the perichoresis, that the movement of love, it's most important for you to see that in verses 21 to 24. Because the movement of love that Jesus is describing there, if I were to put it really, really simply, would be like this. God loves you, you love God, and then God loves you again. It's this movement of loving the way the Father and the Son and the Spirit love. God loves you in Christ, choosing you, giving you salvation, giving you His Spirit. But then don't stop there, which is where way too many Christians do. At that point, Jesus says, love God back. And when you do that by keeping His commandments, listening to His Spirit, Jesus says, then God will love you back. And He describes what that experience is like in verses 21 to 24. Those who love God back, the Father will love them back again, and I, the Son, will show myself to Him. So when you love God back, and God loves you back, Jesus says, the Father will love you, and I'm going to show myself to you. And even more than that, the Father and I are going to reside in you by the Spirit. I have a friend who leads tours in Israel. And one of the places that he takes his groups to is Shiloh. Now, if you're familiar with the Old Testament, you know that Shiloh was the place where the tabernacle was, that was the center of Israel's life as a nation before Jerusalem, before David sacked Jerusalem. Shiloh was the place where the people of God gathered. Now, he takes them up to ancient Shiloh, and they're looking around a non-developed, remote place, and there's all sorts of native geography, and then there's a piece of geography that doesn't fit. There's a piece of geography that is basically a soccer field or a football field. It's about 100 yards long in the middle of this rocky, hilly terrain. There's just this flat piece of earth. And grass, of course, has grown in it. And he takes, my friend takes his tour groups there, and he says, you see that? That's where the tabernacle was. They cleared the earth, they cleared the terrain, and they did it in such a way that it's become permanent. And because it's so remote up there in the northern part of Israel, this was never a profitable place that invaders wanted to occupy, the land stayed there. And so his point is that you are looking at a place where the particular presence of God was on earth. In other words, you can say, most emphatically, God was here with a special presence. Now, Jesus' promise to you when you love God back is that I and my Father will dwell in you just as we dwelt in Shiloh. The power of the presence of God on earth at Shiloh, such that only one consecrated person could even draw near it one time a year, and that not without a series of steps to consecrate themselves to even get near that presence. That presence will reside in you if you believe what I'm saying, Jesus says. That's an amazing promise. And to be honest, the Bible has nothing more to offer you than that. If that's not sufficient for you, nothing will be sufficient for you. If God in you and with you is not sufficient to satisfy your heart, nothing will satisfy your heart, ever. Your heart, as St. Augustine said, will be totally restless until you find rest in that presence of God with you. As we're winding down here, I'd like to share with you some comments from J.C. Ryle, who was the first Anglican Bishop of Liverpool, as he was reflecting on these verses. He said, there's more of heaven on earth to be obtained than most Christians are aware of, such as the friendship of God. Psalm 25:14 says that the friendship of the Lord is for those who fear Him, and He makes known to them His covenant. And how does one befriend God? Ryle asks. By steadily doing Christ's will and walking in Christ's ways. No one has such sensible enjoyment of their religion as the one who, like Enoch, Abraham, and Moses, walks closely with God. Now, I wonder if you know that you can have such intimacy with God. I wonder if you know that God holds Himself out to you like that. I wonder if you're expecting that from God. I mean, there are many in here who do love God. But are you expecting Him to do what He says, to be with you when you think He's not? Are you trusting Him to make His home with you so that you don't have to be afraid of tomorrow? You don't have to be afraid of the next doctor's appointment or the next business meeting or the next whatever, because God is with you. So I have a very simple appeal to make. That is just, would you love God back? Would you keep Jesus' commandments? Would you receive God's Spirit? And would you enjoy God's fellowship? That is the end for which the world was made. And if you do that, know that your voice will join the chorus of those who sing, even now in glory, could we with ink the ocean fill? And were the skies of parchment made, were every stalk on earth a quill, and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above, would drain the ocean dry. Nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. Let us pray. Father in heaven, I don't know that you can say more directly what your purposes with us are than you have or that you do in these verses. Father, you have brought us to the point of seeing what Christianity is really about. And I pray, O God, that we would be overwhelmed with joy at the fact that you not only love us once in sending your Son, but you love us over and over and over as we enter into the community of life that is in heaven and that will be our life. This is the good news of the gospel. The gospel doesn't get any better than hearing that we can enter into friendship and love with the Almighty. And so, Father, I pray that you would move now by your Spirit to win us to living a life that befriends you by doing what Jesus told us to do. And that begins with loving one another just as you have loved us. And we praise you that you've given us the help of your Spirit to this end. And we pray all this together in and through Christ, our Lord. Amen.